We're on? Okay, thank you. Hello, everyone. Welcome to this Mayor and City Council regular session for Monday, December 16, 2013, about 6 p.m. First thing on the agenda is we're going to have the prayer and the pledge. Would you please rise? And the prayers will be given by Council Secretary Knight, and the pledge will follow.
Okay, let us bow our heads. A few Christmas gift requests: for our enemy, forgiveness; for an opponent, tolerance; for a friend, our hearts; for a customer, service; for all, charity; for every child, a good example; for ourselves, respect. We ask that peace be our Christmas gift and our blessing all year through. Amen. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America, and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you, Council Secretary Knight.
You're welcome.
Very nice, very nice. Okay. Next on the agenda is approval of minutes for work session dated November 26, 2013. Also for regular session number 22 dated December 2nd, 2013. And the work session dated December 10, 2013. We'll consider them approved. There's no correction, deletions. So we'll consider them approved. Okay. All right. Next on the agenda is our items presented by the Mayor and City Council, our standing committee reports. We'll start with the Police Commission.
Mr. President, I request the Chief and Lieutenant Harner to come forward and have a seat.
Good evening.
Welcome, Chief.
Good evening, both. Our last meeting was held on December 9th, and the Chief had a great report for us again about the crime statistics, and I'll let him fill us in on that.
Some of the highlights as we get ready to finish off 2013. As I stated in a meeting, crime is down about 13% overall crime. Total Part 1 crime, which is our serious crime, is down in virtually every category, and down also about 13%. As far as officer productivity is up, we've seen officer-initiated calls for service with an increase of 11.6%. And to the contrary, citizens' calls for service have decreased by a little over 12%. Those are some of the highlights. Also, our activity, our productivity in certain areas remains constant. Our DUI enforcement is up considerably this year. That's being one area. Our weapons recoveries are up significantly, a little over 70%. So those items, that productivity on behalf of the officers greatly has attributed to our crime overall decreases for this year. And the numbers that I just spoke of, the increase in officer productivity and the decrease in citizen calls for service, not only for November versus November of 2012, but also in line better this year than last year on an overall basis, a year-to-date basis. So all the indicators are very positive.
Very good.
You're done. Go ahead.
Back in October, Lieutenant Harner brought a proposal to the Police Commission regarding a seatbelt ordinance, and I'm glad he's here tonight to kind of fill us in, because this is something we're going to be voting on later in the meeting. Chief, Lieutenant, you want to fill us in on?
Yeah, I just want to say that Lieutenant Harner has worked very, very diligently, very, very hard on this in an effort to increase our public safety, and this is just another step, another component of that. And if I could defer to him, and he can tout some of his efforts.
Mr. Mayor, members of the council, happy holidays to you and your family. It's always a pleasure to be before you. The police department put forth a proposed ordinance to address in an area where we feel that is left to be addressed and is important to the town. You may not be aware, but in 2012, the town experienced 1,650 motor vehicle collisions. It's an alarming number when you realize and take into context the geographical area of Ocean City. 1,650 motor vehicle crashes, at least, because certainly we know that some people opt to stop and simply exchange information versus report it to the police. Those are the crashes that were reported to the police. Of that, several hundred resulted in injury-related crashes, or crashes that resulted in injuries. That being the case, we put forth this ordinance As you're aware, and I think I've spoke before, on October 1st, the state enacted more stringent seatbelt laws, thus requiring the now rear seat passengers of a motor vehicle to be restrained by a seatbelt. It inherently was concerning to me that for all of us, we could jump in the back of a pickup truck and ride down Coastal Highway at 40 miles an hour, and it would be lawful to do so. But if we were inside of the vehicle, where it's inherently safer to begin with, that the state would require you to be seatbelted in there. So I felt that this was an area that, due to the number of crashes that we encounter in a year's time frame, the number of injury crashes, and the propensity for people, especially with some of our special events that we have, for people to ride in the back of the trucks and open areas of vehicles, that this was an area of concern from a traffic safety perspective. We worked with the city solicitor. We've come up with an ordinance that we were forthright about. It came from Anne Arundel County many years ago. We have examined it for its ability to be adopted by this council. And before you tonight is the proposed ordinance with working with Mr. Ayers and with the support of the state's attorney for Worcester County. Before you is the proposed ordinance.
And Lieutenant, would you also fill them in on the requirements of the ordinance as far as the type of belt, and you still have to have a seat?
Sure. We didn't want to alter what the transportation article says in 25101 allows us dictates what we can and can't do with enacting ordinances. So the ordinance is in line with the Maryland transportation article that it defines seat belt. We adjusted that definition slightly to make it so that the seat belt has to be attached to the motor vehicle. But before you is what we feel is a complete ordinance to address those areas that were left unaddressed by the state.
So someone can't simply go put a lap belt in the back of their pickup truck. They have to have a chair, they have to have a lap belt and a cross belt as
and
well.
It would have to be attached to the body of the motor vehicle. Correct. As the ordinance also, the proposed ordinance says.
Thanks for making that clear.
All right. Councilmember Ashley, have a question?
Are you done? Hey, go ahead with your finish.
You want to finish your report?
Yeah.
Chief, could you give us the stats on the taser use for last month?
The taser, we had one event. It actually didn't result in a deployment of the taser. It was an aiming. It was a hostile subject. Once that the taser was aimed at the subject, there was compliance. There was no injury to any party, and that was the first day of the month and the only incident for taser usage.
Very good.
Okay, Council Secretary Knight had asked us to look into a particular drug that she had heard about recently, and we passed that on to the police department. They're looking into that. And the only other item is at the next police commission meeting, I believe we have a gentleman coming before us to put on a demonstration regarding a vehicle for rent. It's called the trike, and that meeting will be held on January 13th at 9 a.m. at the Public Safety Building if anyone has any interest.
All right, Councilmember Ashley.
I'll yield.
Chief, congratulations on the crime statistics. You know, I hope the bad guys know that we definitely have a new sheriff in town, and they'll respond accordingly. I do have a question, though. I spoke to you this morning about a citizen that called in a observation of criminal activity, and I don't know the answer to this. Maybe Doug does or you do. Is our tip line still active for crime? We have a crime tip hotline. It used to be 410-520-5136. Is that still?
I'm not sure.
Does anybody know if that's?
I don't know.
All right. Perhaps Mr. Recor could find that out, and if it's not active, maybe we could activate it and post it on the government station on the cable so that we have more eyes in the community watching for criminal activity that can report. Yes. have a mechanism to report it.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Thank you.
Okay. All right. Anybody else for the police commission? Okay.
I was going to say I'm pretty sure it's there because we put it there for the graffiti.
Okay.
So people could call in for the graffiti, so I'm hoping it's still there.
I can check it.
Yeah, we'll find it out.
Yeah, and it's a good idea to post it.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Lieutenant, Chief, thank you. Thank you for being here.
Thank you.
Okay.
Happy holidays.
All right. Oh, Mr. Mayor.
Yeah, while the Chief and the Lieutenant are here, do you think we should go ahead and bring forward the ordinance? That way, if there's any questions by anybody, the ordinance is here, and they're here and can speak to it as well. Mr. Ayers, would that be appropriate? Guy?
Sure.
Would that be okay to do? That way, if there's any questions, it is an ordinance. Anybody in the audience, we also have the chief and the lieutenant both here.
Okay. All right, Guy, you want to do that? We'll move item 9 up.
16.
Ordinance 2013-16 for first reading. The ordinance to amend Chapter 90 entitled Traffic of Vehicles. It recategorizes the helmets and shoes ordinances, which are 90-211 and 90-212, under a Division 1 called Helmets and Shoes. It creates a Division 2 called Seat Belts, establishes the definition for motor vehicle. And a motor vehicle in our definition includes any float or trailer towed, pulled, or powered by a motor vehicle. And also the definition of seat belt, which conforms with both the Transportation Article of Maryland and the Federal Transportation Act. And we've added, which is permanently attached to the body of the motor vehicle. And this would prohibit individuals to ride in the unenclosed area of any motor vehicle without being restrained by a seatbelt.
Okay.
And then there are certain exceptions or exemptions, which would be passengers in municipal sanctioned or approved parades during the parade and in the parade route. Two would be federal, state, county, and municipal emergency vehicles. And three would be municipal vehicles during the course of municipal duties.
Thank you, Guy. Councilmember Pills?
I make a motion to pass on first reading ordinance to amend Chapter 90 entitled Traffic and Vehicles, section, is it section or subsection, seatbelts. Seatbelts.
Division two,
seatbelts.
Right. Councilmember Knight?
Second.
I have a motion by Councilmember Pills and a second by Councilmember Knight. Discussion? Councilmember Ashley?
Well, I'm in favor of this 100%. Now, in my research, I did find out that most states don't address this issue at all. And the ones that do only applies to children under 16, okay? So, I think this is a great idea for public safety, which I'm all for. But I also like the idea that it's going to cut down on the rowdiness of the people riding up down the road with the flags and yelling out of the back of the pickup truck. So I think it's twofold, public safety, number one, but more quality of life, number two. So I support it 100%.
All right, we got a motion and a second. All those in favor? Vote is unanimous. All right. Okay, thank you.
Thank you, gentlemen.
Thank you. All right, go back to the standing committee reports. The next one is the Tourism Commission. Council Secretary Knight?
Yes, and I see that Donna's here, Donna Abbott, who is our department head in charge of tourism. We met on December 4th. Some of the items covered was, and I also see that Larry Nocolino is here, that he announced that the phase two construction of the Performing Arts Center will be done approximately November of 2014. He's hoping to have a promoter-sponsored kickoff presentation performance on Saturday, November the 29th. That will be extremely exciting because that's Thanksgiving weekend. Folks are always in town. It will be something new. It will be just, I think, an extremely exciting event to kick off the Performing Arts Center. We're also looking at January 18th of 2014 for the OC Stars and the Mid-Atlantic Symphony. So there are things that are happening in that arena. The chamber mentioned that the 2014 vacation guide is currently at the printer and probably, Donna, is it out now?
It should be delivered to us either later this week or first thing next week. So we're ahead of schedule, actually.
Exactly, and that's important because as soon as we have it, we get requests, and it's good for people who do plan early for their vacations. A group of business leaders, along with Susan Jones, met with Senator Mikulski on the previous Monday to talk about the J-1 visa program, and that was a good, I think, hour and 45-minute conversation. Donna also mentioned Rodney made national news because he did, well, kind of carry a bride down the aisle. He walked her down the aisle and also carried her down the aisle, which, do you want to say something about that, Donna, a little bit of the background?
Well, yeah, that was kind of a special request that we had received. The bride had lost her father a few months before the wedding, and her then-fiancé suggested, kind of half as a joke, maybe Rodney can walk you down the aisle. Apparently, the couple drives by a Rodney billboard in the central Pennsylvania area every day, and they see it. It makes them think about Ocean City. So we thought maybe as a, you know, to help and as a, to get some publicity out of it, to be honest with you, that we would try to work this out. And the brides paid for the transportation fees. We did send out a photo alert after the event occurred. We did give in to the bride's wishes not to have the media present at the ceremony, but to get the follow-up with that. And we'd had some great local and regional coverage, and then the story ran in USA Today. So I'd say we got a lot of bang there for the buck. And I think it shows Ocean City as a wedding destination and the fact that Rodney's very popular. And the bride was just absolutely thrilled. The guests at the wedding had no idea that Rodney was going to be doing this, and everyone just had a blast, apparently. So it turned out to be a very positive event.
Margaret?
Yeah, Donna, you mentioned that they paid for travel.
Mm-hmm.
Did we incur any cost in that?
We paid a $500 fee for Rodney to be there. And that was well below what his normal appearance fee is, but we paid nothing else other than that. And he was just there for the wedding, and I feel that we got more than $500 worth of coverage out of that. More than. Way more than.
I know, but I wasn't. Is that a decision made on your level? That's okay to make that decision?
I did go to the city manager to ask him if we could do that, and we discussed it. As long as we got the coverage out of it, which we did, and we knew we would, we did that.
Yeah, but that's a private event. I certainly don't want to get into a habit.
We even had Dave Messick do some video as well, some promotional video that we can continue to use.
Yes.
And we had national coverage in USA Today, but Donna did come to me and discuss it, and well worth the money.
All right, Brent?
Well, I think the Rodney wedding, I think that's a perfect example, again, of thinking outside the box. Now, here's an idea that came to us from a private citizen that got national attention. So you never know where your ideas are going to come from. I'd also like to say, and I haven't seen it, but I've been told by numerous people in the community that the bikini parade that we did back in 2012 is now being shown on the Travel Channel. So.
Oh, I think the Travel Channel, there were a couple of different productions there. One, they were down doing a boardwalk segment, which I think happened to be going on at the same time that they were in town and they were able to.
No, I think they came specifically for the bikini parade, if I remember correctly.
Okay.
But again, it's just an outside-the-box idea that got us a lot of publicity. So, okay, thank
you. Okay. Tom Schuster stated that for the first weekend, Thanksgiving weekend, for the Winter Festival Lights, we were at a good start. We had 18,000 visitors, which was more than we had last year. We then went to closed session, and the commission voted unanimously to forward the campaign creative and interactive projects proposed to the mayor and council. They voted unanimously for us to present it in our next executive session, what our campaign's going to be next year. And the next meeting will be held on January 13th at 3 p.m. in room 214.
That's the Tourism
Convention
Commission
Center.
Meeting, right.
Yes.
I scheduled the council to hear the creative, the advertising campaign creative on January 14th.
Okay, great. Thank you.
Okay, Councilmember Ashley.
Well, I know this is probably after the fact, and you've already got your campaign created, but, you know, we just had the Ping Pong Summer accepted by the Sundance Film Festival, so I hope there's some room somewhere for promoting this idea. I mean, we've had, in the last 3 years, a Summer of Thanks. We had a Lucky Summer of 13. I believe Ping Pong Summer is set in the summer of 1985, so somewhere we might be able to do something summer of 1985. This is an additional promotion or campaign to promote the movie that's going to promote Ocean City.
The campaign, we have ideas, and there's and that's what's going to be presented to us. Nothing's really in concrete yet, and there's always, like you said, at the end of the advertisement, there's going to be a trailer, and gosh, I mean, that's a great idea, and a lot of that can be incorporated. So I think you're going to be very pleased. There's four options, but I think you're going to be very pleased, and that could very well work.
And I would hope, too, that maybe even, Donna, you could get with the motels and restaurants and so forth to promote this movie, because we've invested in it as a council.
Absolutely.
So, you know, I mean, just being accepted at the Sundance is a big deal.
It is.
So,
huge deal. And we'll certainly go for everything we can get mileage-wise out of that.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. All right. Thank you, Donna.
Thank you.
Thank you, Council Secretary Knight. Next on the agenda is the consent agenda. We have items A through E. A is request to approve bid solicitations for tennis center fence project. B is request to approve bid solicitation for 150 kW generator. C is request to approve bid solicitation to bus barn roof repairs. D is bid award recommendation for Northside Park Pier redecking project. And E is private event approval request for St. George Blessing of the Waters for January 11th, 2014. Councilman Matresik.
Motion to approve the consent agenda.
Councilmember Ashley.
Second.
I have a motion by Councilmember Matresik and a second by Councilmember Ashley to approve the consent agenda. All those in favor? The vote is unanimous. Thank you. Next on the agenda is the miscellaneous reports and presentations. It's a bid opening for horseback riding services. David, I think you were due at your office.
Thank you, Council President. Unfortunately, after advertising the RFP and making direct contact with nine, I would say, regional operators, we did not receive any responses for the RFP by the deadline on Friday.
All right, Councilmember Matresik.
This is a little bit different, but it was mentioned to me that the existing carriage horse is going on the wooden boardwalk and for some reason doing damage to it. If we could check that out,
absolutely,
get a report back on that, I'd appreciate it.
Yes, sir.
Somebody said that his shoes were dragging on the wood or something and scraping it up. I don't know.
All right. Mr. Mayor.
Actually, I think that might have been something that occurred a while ago, but you better check on it. But they have rubber shoes that they put on the horses, and I believe that's what they've been using. That would prevent that type of damage. But certainly if somebody has seen some damage, it needs to be followed up on.
I haven't seen it myself, but somebody mentioned it to me. So if we could check it out.
Okay. All right. All right. Next on the agenda is discussion of tourism strategic plan, RFP presented by Tourism Director Donna.
Back again. In your package, you have a draft RFP, excuse me, that I prepared working with the city manager since meeting of October 21st when you voted to accept the Tourism Commission's recommendation to proceed with composing such an RFP. So we've put together a draft for your review, and basically it would solicit proposals for a five-year strategic plan evaluating the town's tourism needs, its assets, and conducting a market analysis to incorporate it into the plan that would basically serve as a blueprint for us over the next 5 years. Put it together. I did get some input from the state tourism director as well. They went through a similar process a few years ago and found it very helpful. Theirs is much more broader than what this one attempts to solicit. They were, you know, having to deal with the legislature that from different areas that maybe tourism is not as important as it is here. So I don't think we need to focus on getting input on support for tourism. I think we all agree that tourism is the basis of our economy here. So put together a draft for your review. Basically, the project overview, as I mentioned, solicits a proposal for a five-year plan. I put in a community profile for background information for those who will be considering putting a bid in for this. And then I listed the desired outcomes, which I would be more than happy to receive feedback from you on tonight. First off, we would identify the key geographic and demographic targets with the highest return on investment potential. Then we would have them look at specialty markets with the highest return on investment potential. And by specialty, I mean sports marketing, golf, all those various different segments that are, you know, a part of tourism, but are more narrowly defined. We would also hope to get a vision, goals, and objectives for the Department of Tourism for the fiscal year 2015 through 2020. And that, I think, would also help the Tourism Commission as they meet and review plans, and we bring back to the full council for review and discussion. And then a strategic planning document that would contain all of the above. So I would ask for your input on this. If you would like to proceed, we'll certainly move forward with this. But this was something that started with the Tourism Commission, coming to you all endorsed it, and now I'm coming back to you now with this draft to consider for voting tonight.
Okay. All right. Councilmember Tressig.
Well, I'd make a motion that we accept the RFP as written and to move forward with it.
All right. Councilmember Ashley.
Second with a comment.
I got a motion by Councilmember Tressig and a second by Councilmember Ashley. Go ahead with your comment.
Well, to me, this is way overdue and much needed. You know, I see figures sometimes that, you know, we're up room tax and sale and food tax and so forth. And for me, I've lived in the same corner for 40 years, and I can see that I have doubts about how that's coming about. I think, you know, the last couple of years we've been in a holding pattern, basically just trying to keep even. I think Councilmember Tressig summed it up very well, if I remember right, when he said the new up is now even. So, you know, I think this is the way we have to go to move forward and to increase our tourism. So I think it's definitely needed and overdue. So I'm all for it.
All right. Motion. Councilmember Knight, you on?
Yes. I just had a comment. The Volusia County, where Daytona Beach is, I have their strategic plan for tourism. It was very, very, very well done, and I see a lot of the things that the outcome we're asking for. One thing I saw in theirs that was important to me was the importance of events in tourism. And they compared their private events and which ones did have the biggest return on investment. And it was kind of counterintuitive and something that down here we all say. The Daytona 500 was much more, had a much better demographic and a higher income, et cetera, than Bike Week in Daytona Beach. So, and I know we always discuss what events bring in the most money and the people that spend the most money. So as part of it, I would really like to see one of the desired outcomes is something to the effect of, you know, the importance of events in some measurement that we can see if we have a new event, some formula that we can say, yes, we should invest $100,000 in this because it will bring what we want versus it's a good idea and I'd like to build a castle in the sand on the beach because it would be fun. Okay. So that was about the only thing I saw different. And I'll share this with you, this Volusia County, because as I said, I think they completed it in April of 2013. Okay. It was very relevant.
Okay. Good idea, Mary, because events are very important.
And that's the only thing I saw.
Okay. All right. Councilmember Pills.
Yes, you mentioned that it's costing $40,000. Is that for the marketing research only, or is that for the plan?
That is a line item I have in the budget that we previously spent on evaluating our advertising campaign 2 years ago. And that is something that I just kind of held there as a placeholder. We agreed, council agreed, not to do that last fiscal year because we had just done one the year before, and the agency recommended, and you all concurred, that didn't really make sense to do it every year and spend $40,000. So this fiscal year, I put it back in there thinking we would do that, and then this came up, the discussion came up, and so I decided that that would be a starting place for us to use to fund this RFP.
Mr. Recor, what did it cost us to do a strategic plan for the that we just went through with you? And
we had budgeted $20,000.
So did we manage to go over that, or did we?
Slightly over that.
So this line item should probably cover
what we're doing.
Well,
I think the more narrow
it's double the amount.
The more narrow the focus, you're what you're asking your consultant to look at, the less expensive it would be. And I would say that the process that we went through last year was much more broad-based and community-wide, really, than this would be.
Okay. And you didn't mention in your report, you mentioned a year 2009, 2010, 2013, you were talking about an increase in tourism dollars, $3 million to almost $4 to almost $5. You left out 11 and 12. Is there a reason for that?
Probably they were the same, I believe.
Mm-hmm.
I'll have to look into that. Okay. But I'm pretty sure those were the same amounts, pretty much. 2010, I put in $3.9 million. Yes, I just put in the most recent. That was 2013. But I can include those in there.
Yeah, you know, well, the point is it went from, you know, it looks like it jumped a million each time. You know what I mean? So I guess 2010 or 11, it probably jumped a half a million.
I can put in
the last 11 and 12.
I can put in the last 5 years.
In it?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, Councilmember Knight.
And I forgot to mention, I received a letter from the HMRA, and their board was unanimous in this decision and very excited about going forward with a strategic plan, for the record.
Okay. All right, I got a motion by Councilmember Tressig and a second by Councilmember Ashley to move forward with the RFP. All those in favor? Vote is unanimous. Donna, thank you.
Thank you.
Yep. Okay. All right. Next on the agenda, items presented by the city manager. David?
Thank you, Mr. President. Well, on the heels of that discussion regarding a strategic plan for tourism and marketing, to present to you an update on the townwide strategic plan that we embarked on last year. You'll all recall that as part of that initiative, we established a vision for the town of Ocean City, as well as a mission statement, and established five-year goals. To implement those five-year goals, Mayor and Council adopted both a prioritized policy agenda as well as a management agenda. And earlier this evening, I gave each of you a handout that essentially follows the construct of your plan in brief. The policy agenda with your top priorities and high priorities, as well as the management agenda with top priorities and high priorities. That plan in brief effectively was the overarching work plan for 2013 and into 2014. And the way that I've set this table up is to identify the action according to the agenda, which goal, which of the five goals that it affects, whose responsibility, who was assigned for implementation of that specific action, the milestones or activities that we identified. We didn't just establish an action, we actually thought about how we were going to accomplish that action. And those milestones and activities have been listed. The quarter in which we imposed a self-imposed deadline, and as you'll see, I look at them kind of fluidly as a guideline for the department heads that the tasks have been delegated, and where we need to adjust due to competing priorities, I recognize that as the manager. And the last column simply gives you the status of where we are as of today, December 16th. Your first priority on the policy agenda was pedestrian safety master plan. It's no secret, I think the pedestrian safety campaign over the summer was very successful by the State Highway Administration. It reduced pedestrian incidents by more than 40%, and staff continues to work with SHA on a number of other initiatives. As far as the long-term projects that were identified with that action, the State Highway Administration appeared before you in November. And while we didn't achieve all of our goals, they presented projects that were prioritized for further discussion. Alternative revenue sources. There were a number of activities that were listed here. We initially, I believe, had finance assigned to this responsibility. There's been some discussion about shifting that responsibility to the budget manager. but here we find ourselves right at the beginning of the preparation for FY15. So it's while the revenue sources book was updated, the actual report and the identification of alternative sources has yet to be completed. Tax differential was a priority and a priority for the entire council. You did authorize the completion or update of the study completed by Municipal and Financial Services Group. That was completed in February of 13. There's been additional research on the transfer and recordation taxes and county grants compared to assessments that the finance director completed in October. The additional milestones, the preparation for the joint meeting with the county, the meeting with the county commission, these were milestones or activities that we established during discussion. Unfortunately, we advised the county that we were interested in discussing tax differential, but we never did make it to the point where we actually had a formal meeting with the county commissioners. As far as the council direction and decision goes, I would say that we continue to recognize that this is a top priority for the mayor and council. I know the mayor has completed the notice to the county, advising the county that we wish to engage in tax differential discussion. The mayor, council, city solicitor, manager, and staff will be evaluating our options, alternatives, and our legal negotiating strategies if it comes to that. Something that I don't think we'll ever forget is a discussion on parking. It was listed as a top priority in the strategic plan, and hence that's why we followed through with the discussion. Staff had completed an internal evaluation of all the public parking lots, the street ends, and specific commercial areas. And during the FY14 budget process, you'll recall that staff presented a number of options and alternatives as far as implementing the parking. The council did decide to move forward with a trial program for paid parking. It was implemented, however, shortly rescinded after the public outcry. So at this point, there's no further action currently planned by staff regarding paid parking. Services with the county regard to EMS and ambulance can tell you that the fire department has been compiling statistics for a number of years, and we'll be prepared to present a comparative analysis to the council regarding the service levels provided by the town of Ocean City compared to industry standards in the third quarter of this fiscal year. At that time, council decision, policy action, you should be in a position to decide how you'd like to move forward. Canal dredging was no coincidence that after you adopted the capital improvement plan and we came back to you for additional projects and activities that could be pay-go funding, that we brought back canal dredging. And you saw fit to allocate $500,000 in PAYGO funding to dredge three canals. Bid opening is tentatively scheduled for January of 14, and we anticipate construction from February to May of 14. Another checkbox on your top priority is the item that you just approved, a tourism evaluation and market analysis. And as Councilmember Ashley said, it's been a long time coming. And now we can move forward with it. But as part of that, one of the very first things that your director of tourism completed was a new tourism metrics report that is presented at each tourism commission meeting. I believe she also presented that to the full mayor and council shortly after it was introduced to the tourism commission. But what that does is it provides a dashboard of statistics regarding hotel occupancy and room and food tax and visitor guide requests and the weather conditions and the website visits to OC Ocean, and that is updated and during season and on the website in the media section. The the Tourism Commission did provide a unanimous recommendation to move forward with the RFP for tourism evaluation and market analysis, and just tonight you've authorized the RFP to move forward. Those were your high priorities on the policy agenda, or your top priorities. You also had a second tier of high priorities, the first of which dealt with retirement and pensions policy. And the milestones associated with this action were addressed during the FY14 collective bargaining process, where we had an actuarial report prepared, and the council based its decision for pension reform largely based on this actuarial report. The council decision, again, was made during the FY14 budget process. We've also talked about a compensation and benefits study to see where we are compensation-wise in the market. There is limited funding included in the FY14 budget for this purpose. The Human Resources Director has prepared a project scope, an outline. He has submitted it to me for my review. And as you can see, the report with recommendations and then the council decision is upcoming in the current fiscal year. Something that we had discussed, but we actually never assigned a responsibility or established milestones and time frame, but was a changing facility at the park and ride location. I did speak with the city engineer. You know, we do have a partner in the park and ride lot, and I think in terms of an activity or a milestone, first thing we need to do is make sure that we're not in conflict with the agreement that we have with the Maryland Transportation Authority. But we did not include funding in the CIP to move this initiative forward. Another issue that I know has been important to many of you, and that's private events and making sure that private events are paying their way, that we're getting a good return on our investment. One of the first things we did was standardize the memorandum of understanding for every event that's held in Ocean City. We identified the expectations of the promoter, and we've identified the what they can expect of us in return. The special event superintendent has also prepared a draft proposal on guidelines for town-owned equipment and labor usage by outside entities. That's being reviewed by our internal tourism coordination group, and after that internal review is complete, it'll go to the Park Recreation and Parks Commission meeting and then to the full council. There is a new fee structure that's been drafted and prepared by staff, and again, that's ready to go for review to Recreation and Parks and then to the full council. I anticipate that will coincide with this year's budget process. One of your other high priorities was a bike share program, and this was one of those priorities that we need to adjust and recognize the competing priorities with the planning department. So the report with recommendations is in progress. Mr. Margotta has asked to adjust that to the third quarter of FY14. And once the report and recommendations has been prepared, we adjust the council decision, policy decision to the fourth quarter. Dedicated bus lane for Coastal Highway that was included in the approved the actual design was included in the capital improvement plan for 2016. Recognizing that that is 2 years away, that affects the second and third milestones, so they are yet to be completed. 5-year capital improvement plan. We presented the CIP to the mayor and council on August 27th. The plan was completed and approved on that date, and shortly thereafter we brought back projects that where we used excess fund balance above the council's policy to fund additional projects and activities. Road resurfacing, again, very important priority to the mayor and council. Public Works has completed an evaluation of road conditions. And as part of the FY14 budget, Mayor and Council authorized $2 million in PAYGO road resurfacing funding. I think that does include some grant monies, but You heard me mention PAYGO a lot. I can tell you that in our discussions with the bond rating agencies, the council's commitment to pay cash for capital improvements weighed heavily, I think, in not only maintaining our current rating, but particularly in the increase that we receive from Standard and Poor's. Additional parking revenues, again, I think we've addressed that in the previous goals. We conducted a review, but at this point there's no intention of moving forward with any paid parking. We shift to the management agenda, and there were also top priorities and high priorities. Beach replenishment. We have completed the repairs associated with Hurricane Sandy, we have a beach replenishment project scheduled for the fall of 13. It's a full replenishment project. 4 years advanced nourishment will begin in January of 14. It's being funded 100% by the Army Corps of Engineers through Sandy Storm repair funds that were authorized by Congress. And of course, we all know how important the beach is to Ocean City. So this is a very, very important priority. Citywide five-year financial plan, again, something we've talked about, a multi-year financial forecast. Budget manager has prepared draft assumptions where what we anticipate our property values. Are we going to maintain constant yield? And other assumptions that we need to bring to you to make sure that you're comfortable with them before we do that forecasting. The dual Route 90 bridge, you heard when SHA was here in November, unfortunately did not was not prioritized by Worcester County, but that doesn't mean that, you know, we can't still ask for prioritization, but sounds like that we need to work closely with Worcester County and the State Highway Administration to make sure that becomes a priority with SHA. The comp plan update, we did get a year extension on the comp plan update, and again, Mr. Margotta has requested that the specific milestones regarding the public input and when the plan is due and council adoption to be adjusted to reflect more realistic and accurate time frames. The election system update. This involves the merger of the municipal election with the county election. You all will recall that the mayor prepared a letter to Senator Mathias requesting the merger. We did receive a response from the Office of Attorney General, but there was not a definitive time frame or deadline. We have a municipal election looming, and I think it would be appropriate for us to follow up and make sure that if it's our intent to merge this election by 2013, that we continue to move this forward. There will be a funding component with that. City Clerk has communicated with Worcester County. That's to be determined. I don't want to put a number out there, but there has been communication regarding cost. Police Department organizational study. At the time we had this discussion, I believe it was anticipated that we would go outside. We had just completed the review with ICMA of the communications and dispatch center, and we thought that it would be a good idea to have ICMA or a similar organization do a review of our police department. We've kind of shifted gears with this goal with the hiring of our new chief of police, Ross Bizzorro. And since Ross has been here, he's evaluated the organizational structure. He's done a critical analysis, critical review. He's brought forward a number of structural changes to the police commission. Then have been brought forward to the mayor and council. The chief has also submitted a proposal regarding restructuring hiring of civilian personnel to replace and transition sworn members from administrative to operational duties. So at this point, I don't see us, unless the council sees fit to do otherwise, I don't see us moving forward with a consultant. I think the department is in good hands with Chief Bizzorro and his leadership. Headquarters for Beach Patrol. again, no coincidence we had that discussion. Mr. Derrick and a lot of you will recall it's been a discussion, a long-time discussion, but this year we actually made some progress. Becker Morgan was chosen as the project architect. We had a design kickoff meeting. Council decided to entertain a property swap with the Ocean City Development Corporation. We currently have a memorandum of understanding that is under review at the administrative level. It will be brought forward to the mayor and council for your approval. And then the council did include the project in the bond proceeds with financial support from the OCDC. Significant accomplishment, and as you all know, one that's been long overdue. Just this afternoon, Recreation and Parks Commission met and reviewed revised plans to address the feedback that that you provided just last month. Succession planning, we have a number of HR-related initiatives. The Director of Human Resources has prepared a performance evaluation and tracking system utilizing our HR and IT resources. We've also talked about department head performance appraisals, and Mr. Evans has provided a recommendation to me regarding that matter. Personnel rules and regulations. Again, HR has identified the needed updates and policy clarification to reflect current practices. There's been an internal policy committee identified. We do expect a consulting resource to be utilized, and we'll likely suggest that we go out for RFP. And again, there are dollars allocated in FY14 for this purpose. Did you have a question, council member?
No. Okay.
And the final priority and the management agenda was a reward system for top performers. The activities involved reporting to the council and then a council decision. The HR director has suggested that this report with recommendations be linked to the completion of the compensation and benefit study as part of that initiative. There were a number of major projects that we had on the agenda. And the second to the last page provides you a status report on those projects, first being the Performing Arts Center project. It's in progress. Construction commenced on October 20th, and we have an anticipated completion date of November 2014. Boardwalk project completed. It was completed in April of 2013, ahead of schedule and $1 million under budget. Airport improvements just completed last month. Caroline Street Comfort Station, we can skip over that real quick. Actually, I do need to report to you. You all are aware that it's significantly behind schedule due to weather delays and contractor performance. I did speak to the city engineer, and we're prepared and intend to call the bond this Friday. The suggestion was made for additional foot showers, shower facilities, and that was completed during the boardwalk construction project.
Go ahead, Margaret.
Is that another way of saying that? Was there any penalty?
I believe there are liquidated damages. We've been in liquidated damages for a substantial period of time
since August.
Oh, Mr. McGinnis.
There's Terry right here.
Ah.
Thanks, Terry.
Mm-hmm. It's performance.
The bond is separate from liquidated damages. Whenever we do a contract that's over $100,000, it requires a performance and a payment bond, and the performance bond guarantees that the project will be completed. Basically, it's an insurance policy. So basically, we've told them that if the project is not substantially complete by Friday, that we were going to turn it over to the bonding company. Something that's generally done as a last resort, because once that happens, it's rare that that contract will be able to get bonded in the future. So.
And how much will we get if that was the case?
What they're obligated to do is complete the project. So the bonding company basically then is obligated to take over and complete the project.
They bring in their own people.
Yes. I'm optimistic that is not going to come to that, but we'll see on Friday.
Friday. Yep. I'm going to go down there with flags.
Friday.
Yay.
All right. Go ahead, David.
Public boat ramp, the relocation and expansion. We're actively seeking permits, and we anticipate construction in FY15. Fire station number 4, we're currently under construction, and we have an anticipated completion date of May of 2014. Fire headquarters, the initial conceptual plan was rejected by staff. We do have a second, a revised plan, a second draft that's currently under review. We'll be reviewing that with council members that are interested, and then we anticipating presenting a final draft of the plan to the mayor and council third quarter FY14. And finally, under major projects, we have the St. Louis Avenue improvement project, which we completed earlier this year. There are a number of management in progress issues with the capital improvement budget, the impact of the Obamacare and health care reform, which you all will recall we decided to address by through management initiative, labor contracts with both our police union and fire union, preparation of an FY14 budget with constant yield, compensation decision for our general employees, police chief selection, web-based building permits and business licenses, which I should advise the council that while we had hoped to go live, fully live on January 1, don't know that we're going to be able to reach that goal. We may be able to move forward with some miscellaneous permitting, but not every permit that's issued by the building department. And it's due in large part to adequate training of the staff. We don't want another Affordable Health Care Act experience in Ocean City. We want to do it right. And I know that several of you on the council have a vested interest in this, but when we do it, we want to do it right.
Absolutely.
And again, just wrapping up here, some of the other management in progress issues, an interim operation plan for Fire Station 4, you all know how we handled that. We moved it to Recreation and Parks, and then the a Sustainable Communities Plan, which has been completed and forwarded on to the state. So I think that when you look in total of where we are, where what we said we wanted to do and how we were going to do it, I think it's a fairly good report card. I also think it's time for us to be thinking about next year's work program, next year's priorities.
Exactly.
And with the council's approval, I will engage Mr. Sumick and get him scheduled. And while our vision won't change, our mission won't change, and our five-year goals won't change, your priorities will. And so we will engage the department heads to go through a similar effort to identify issues and activities, and then have similar discussion as we did last year with the full mayor and council to adopt your new policy agenda and management agenda for the next year.
Okay. Councilmember Pillis.
A question for you back on St. Louis improvements phase 2. Is that ahead of schedule? It seems so. Is that doing?
Terry,
what's the progress there?
Not here, but
I know Hal is
Hal. Managing,
but
I can tell you Hal told me that they were on schedule, if not a little bit ahead of schedule, because I asked them about that. Mm-hmm. Since you know, it's not something you see, I don't see as much as I did the first phase because of where it is, but he said yes, they're moving forward.
But I can tell you everybody around in the community talking about it, the fact that they don't work on Fridays, so you have Friday, Saturday, and Sunday off, that has been a blessing, you know, because it starts at 7 in the morning and it goes until 5, and then you get this 3-day break. So that's been a really good schedule.
And if they're on schedule or ahead of schedule, that's even better.
Oh, perfect. Weather holds out, we'll drive in another 4 months or so.
All right, Councilmember Ashley.
Well, Mr. Recor, this is so comprehensive and so well done. Does that mean we don't have to come to any more meetings? Or looks like it's all done for us. This is really terrific. Well, this is great. It lays it right out. Couldn't be any better, so thank you.
You're welcome. Appreciate that.
All right, Mr. Mayor.
Yes, I'm going to take a moment to echo that as well, and I agree with Councilman Ashley, and I know that one of the things we discussed when you came to Ocean City was strategic planning, and you had a plan in place, and you presented that to us, and what you did is you followed through, and it went exactly, or pretty close to exactly, as you had laid out to us. And it got everybody engaged. It got all of us, you know, around the table and talking about the same issues, which is important. And from a managerial standpoint, that's the right thing to do. And you were able to accomplish that. So I think it's a great accomplishment. I think when you look at this, we have been successful in a number of most everything that was there. Or if it hasn't been completed, it's moving forward. So I look forward to working on this again after the first of the year, so we can continue on this positive direction.
Thank you, Mayor.
Thank you, David. Good job.
All right. That, I want to echo what the mayor said and what Brent said it too as well, because, I mean, basically we are moving forward. There's no backwards here, you know. The goals we set, we're going to be there in 2018. I mean, it's just the financially sound town government. We're there. First-class resort and tourist destination. We're there. More livable community and for residents. We're there. We're getting there. We're moving forward with the paving projects. Excellent services through high-performing town organizations. We have the best employees out there. We really do. And revitalizing Ocean City development and redevelopment. We're there. Beach Patrol headquarters. We're moving forward. That's 2018 goals. You know, as we move forward, there'll be 2019 goals. And we're going to move in that same direction and hopefully continue to move forward. So I want to thank everybody up here. We've done a good job, and thank everybody out there as well.
And that's a good point, Council President, because it's all of you had a large part in establishing.
And the town staff is doing a great job as well. So I want to thank everybody out there that took part in that. So
and the citizens as well.
Oh yes, absolutely. Oh, the citizen participation was very, very welcome. It really was. It's what they want for their town. So, all right, okay, moving on. Next on the agenda is comments from the public. Any person who may wish to speak on any matter at a regular session may be heard during comments from the public for a period of 5 minutes or such time as may be deemed appropriate by the council president. Anyone wishing to be heard shall state their name and address and the subject on which he or she wishes to speak. All right. Yes, ma'am.
Ellie Diggleman, 106 120th Street, Ocean City, Maryland. On this last agenda item that was just discussed, I think I understand why the update wasn't included in the packet information, because it's obviously a lot of information. But number one, will it be available to the public online pretty soon?
Well, you can have a copy tonight. And,
okay.
And
it sounded like it was a lot more than just that, but okay.
It is still a lot. It really is. A lot has been done. So.
Yeah. Okay. And I realize that it probably wasn't put online so that people like me wouldn't question it, every little line about it. So I do appreciate that. Another thing concerning that same topic and one other topic, I think, twice tonight I've heard the words constant yield, which makes me a little bit nervous because it makes me think that it's a preamble for raising the constant yield tax rate come April or June or whatever. So I just want to know if that's something we should anticipate or maybe some assurance that it has nothing to do with that.
I don't think it has anything to do with that. So.
And just so you understand and the viewing audience understands, all constant yield is the tax rate that's required to generate the same amount of revenue in the current fiscal year.
Okay. So. Yeah, I realize that, but time has passed when we've been actively involved
in good
following that.
You can reduce it.
Okay, yeah. All right. I just didn't know if there was something that we should anticipate come April, May, June during the departmental budget hearings and so forth. The other things I wanted to discuss were on the tourism strategic plan, RFP. I was kind of confused about the timeline on page 37. There's only like four components to it. I was kind of confused. It seemed like it was sort of backwards, and I thought, obviously, I'm misunderstanding something about that. So if that could be clarified. And then what were the black vertical lines indicative of on that same page? It's a real brief page.
We'll have Donna get with you.
And then also, the last question I had was also about the tourism strategic plan, was how is this different from, although I know it's a strategic plan versus something else that they've asked for in the past, but how is this different from past efforts we've had with consultants, marketing firms, advertising agencies, and so forth to try and zero in on a crystal ball or a, to try and tell how we can maximize on our budget?
Right.
Well, I would answer that, Ellie, is I think Mr. Recor is somewhat of an expert in strategic planning.
Okay.
As he's already demonstrated. So okay, but I think with his guidance on this, I think we will get to a different result.
Okay. All right.
Okay, than we have in the past, perhaps.
But in the past, we've solicited the proposals from consultants, marketing firms, advertising agencies. Is that the same people that were? No?
Yep.
I'm confused.
Yep. Well, we'll get all the answers to you. Just go ahead, and that way you don't,
And give us a chance on that one.
Yep.
Okay. Yeah, I definitely want to give it a chance. It's just I'm trying to understand a little bit more about it. I think that's all my questions.
All right. Thank you.
Thank you.
All right. Thank you. All right. Anyone else in the audience? Yes, sir.
Tony Crist, 403 Bayshore Drive, Bay Vista number 18. Good evening.
Good evening. Just
thinking of what few remarks I can make to sum up my year with you all. And one thing I wanted to say is that a community is only as strong as its weakest link. And I had occasion to go and cook at Thursday night at one of the soup lines. And it surprised me because I saw I prepared a Great Northern Bean Soup, and I bought 40 hot dogs that went out real quick. But there were over 100 people. And I also came to learn that there are people living in tents within a few miles of here, reminiscent of Depression-era days. So I just throw that out because I don't see how any community can build any edifice in the face of that reality and claim too great of a success. The other thing that has puzzled me a lot of the year, the mayor and I have gone back and forth over the health of Ocean City, and room tax has come up quite often because we've actually done fairly well and we've increased room taxes since 2010. And I called Tammy today and I got boned up on room tax. We were up 6% 2010 to 2011, 5% 2011 to 2012, and 3% 2012 to 2013. And in light of that, though, gross revenues were down. And also in light, and this gets to Mr. Recor's constant return, also in light of a tax increase, gross tax revenues were down. And this has been precisely my point. Every economy has a point at which the next increase produces less. And I don't know. I don't have a crystal ball. I don't know if we're there, but I've suspected we're very close to that point. In light of the increases in room tax, the total revenues were down. In light of an increase in property tax, 6%. Also, this winter, I think it's noteworthy, and also because up through October, we had a very mild fall. 82nd Street Restaurant's leaving town, Bayside. Secrets is closing more often than they were. Fager's is closing. Layton's breakfast restaurant on 16th Street that's never closed in the winter is closed now. These are all other indicia of the whole picture. not just the room tax. The room tax, I asked Tammy to go and take a careful look at it, and she actually called me back before the meeting. I was curious because I suspected it was concentrated right at the top, and so it was. The top 10 hotels were up in the month of October 24%. The city was up 11, a little over 11. The paper here it says 12. It was 11 something. So that indicates to me that what I've been hearing in the vast majority, the other 80%, is that they're not doing that well. I bring these up because I think we all leave better off if we know what is and don't go out. And particularly you all have to make decisions next year. I wish we could make decisions that address these things. And you must recognize policies that you embrace as good policies. You also have to embrace unintended consequences from them. So that just as you embrace a policy and say it led to a good result, you can't divorce the soup lines in town and not claim them. I mean, God, you had a man burn up right across the street from here just a few days ago. Now, if Chief Bezerra was still here, I'd ask him if it was necessary to unplug the heaters. Was he afraid a fuse would be blown from the people under the pier who were trying to plug into the Christmas lights, if that was necessary? But anyway, I think that it's a mixed bag. But I think, too, it's incumbent upon the council to think about these things over the holidays and come back and start to address them. I wish you all a very good holiday. Anyway, and I've got three articles that I wanted to hand out. And then one talks about the rise in homelessness. So it's not only Ocean City. And the other one is that Demi Flush was down in October. You know, I guess we're just getting people in town that don't bathe and drink. But anyway, that one shows the Demi Flush statistics. This one talks about the dangers of pensions. And it says there's 1,000% increase in the dangers. It's a pretty good article. And wish you all Merry Christmas.
We thank Happy you for your comments, sir. And all right. Anyone else in the audience? Yes, sir. Come on up. A Ravens fan.
Oh, yep.
Getting close to that time.
Chris Norris, president of the Ocean City ARP chapter. I really wasn't going to say anything this evening, but I felt compelled to come up here and say something to the mayor and city council. First, I want to talk about horseback riding. I received 16 emails from various and sundry members of our group. Of the 16, four I knew were of age. They probably were not going to ride a horse, but I wanted to call them anyway to find out why they were interested in this. And they were not interested in themselves, but they were interested in their grandchildren coming in and spending money in Ocean City and visiting with them. And of the four that answered that question, two said that they only see their grandchildren when they have specific events in Ocean City that brings them to Ocean City, i.e. the lights and so forth and so on. So I wanted to pass that on because I know these 16 watch television, and they read the newspapers, and I think they're going to be maybe a little upset that there were no bids on the horseback riding. And my second item is that I attend all of the city council meetings, mayor and city council meetings. And being this may be the last meeting for 2013.
It is.
I, as a non-resident of Maryland, Ocean City, if I were a resident, I would really be upset with people that constantly come to this meeting and raise the devil with you seven up here that why you're not doing certain things and so forth and so on. These 16 people that called me on this horseback riding, I thought this would be a good opportunity to ask these 16 what they, and I knew they were all residents of Ocean City. They spend a lot of money in Ocean City because I know them all personally. and I thought it'd be a good idea to ask them what they thought of Ocean City, talking to them on the telephone. This was only the last week and a half. They are extremely happy to live here, very happy with the mayor and city council and what they're doing, how they're spending the money in Ocean City. They would not leave Ocean City. They do not leave for the holidays. They want to stay here, see the pretty lights. But we never, ever hear that from certain persons that come before this council all the time and constantly raise hell with you all. So on behalf of the 16 people and the majority of the members of the Ocean City AARP chapter, I want to thank you all very much for the job, fine job you're doing. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thanks. Nice to hear that. All right. Anyone else in the public? Nobody in the audience? Anybody else? Okay, it's time for comments from the Mayor and City Council. Councilmember Phyllis? Yep, make sure to turn down. There you go.
Am I on? Okay. Yep. I just want to wish everybody a Merry Christmas, Happy New Year's, safe traveling during the holidays, and I'm praying for no snow, but I know people like snow on Christmas. So if it comes, let it leave the next day. And just to make a comment about, this is a forum for people to come and discuss their opinions if they don't agree with us. And I want to make sure, you know, the United States stays that way, that we can take criticism and we can listen to it. And in many times we do make the changes they suggest. So I just wanted to mention that. So have a happy holiday.
All right. Thank you, Margaret. Councilmember Matresi?
Well, I wanted to thank Mr. Norris for his comments. Unfortunately, we live in an age when people are happy, they don't take the time out to come down here and voice their happiness. People tend to voice their displeasure more than they do their happiness, and it seems to be that way more and more out in the, with everything. So you get used to it. And I also would like to say Merry Christmas and Happy New Year, and I hope everybody has a safe and happy holiday if they travel or if they're staying here in town. And it can snow an inch between noon and 12
say.
On New Year's Day at the airport would be okay with me. So, I'll see you all after the first of the year.
All right. Thank you, Joe. Councilmember Ashley?
Well, Merry Christmas from me as well, and Chris, thank you as well. But for me, I kind of like the citizen involvement, okay? I mean, you know, we take a beating sometimes, but that's part of the job. I'd rather take a beating and listen to people than not have anybody involved or concerned about what's happening up here. So it's a fine line, but you have to take the good with the bad, and I think we all appreciate citizens' participation. So I'm just glad that people do come down and say what they want to say. So thank you.
All right. David?
Thank you, Mr. President. I did have two things. Next regular session is January 6th, after the first
thank
of the
you.
Year. We do have a work session on January 14th. And second thing is, traditionally, in the interest of public safety, the mayor and council have authorized free bus service on New Year's Eve. Mm-hmm. And since this is our last meeting, I'd like to ask you to authorize free bus service mm-hmm. from 6 a.m. New Year's Eve to run through 6 a.m. on New Year's Day.
All right. Okay, Councilmember Matresi?
Motion to approve the request and have free bus service on New Year's Eve.
All right, thank you. Councilmember Simak?
I'd like to second that.
We got a motion by Councilmember Matresi and a second by Councilmember Simak to approve the free bus rides on New Year's Eve. All those in favor? The vote is unanimous. Thank you, David.
Thank you.
Thanks for bringing that up. Mm-hmm. So, Councilmember Knight?
Are you finished, David?
Yes, ma'am.
Completed. I'm sorry. Yeah. Mm-hmm. I just wanted to say also Merry Christmas to everybody. And if you really want to get in the holiday spirit, this weekend we watched The Bishop's Wife. We watched I'm Dreaming or White Christmas. We tried to find the Holiday Inn, but we couldn't. So it really does kind of put things back into perspective, watching those movies from the 40s and seeing what was really important to them versus what's important to us today. So, you know, have a great holiday and, again, be safe.
Thank you. All right. Councilmember Dare.
Well, sometimes it seems like the wheels of government turn awfully slow. So it was really refreshing tonight as David went through the strategic plan to see everything that's been accomplished in the last year. Mm-hmm. So I'm looking forward to another year like that and wish you all a Merry Christmas.
Yeah.
Thank you.
All right.
Yeah. Councilmember Steinmeier.
Merry Christmas, and hope you all have a great holiday. See you next year.
All right. I got to tell you, you know, went and visited Santa Claus at Winterfest of Lights. He's going to be there until 23rd, and he has to go back to New North Pole to get his sled loaded up. So I invite you all to get out there, the Winterfest of Lights, go see Santa. He's still there right now, but he'll be leaving very soon. So Merry Christmas. Mr. Mayor.
Just a couple of things. First, I'd like to congratulate the promoters and the directors of the Ocean City Christmas Parade. It was a great parade. I know Doug's involved in that, and Harry Howe and a number of others from the Gold Coast Mall. And they got that unique little opportunity there with the weather. I know it was a little bit sketchy as you were going through the night, but it was a great parade. It was nice to see everybody out and in Christmas spirit here in Ocean City. We do have some things coming up. I want to remind everybody that we will be having the Mayor and Council open house on New Year's Day, since we don't meet again till then. I want to make sure everybody's aware of that. This year, we're going to be featuring the Downtown Association, and they will be here with the displays in City Hall, in the chambers here, of the downtown and all the project they've done, and a little bit of history about the Downtown Association. And they will also have storytellers up in the mayor's office and the city manager's office talking about the Downtown Association and a little bit of then and now. So that should be a great event. That parallels the Penguin Swim that takes place up at 91st Street. 91st Street, and that's a great event for the hospital here in Ocean City. So there's a lot of things going on in town. Winterfest of Lights, as Lloyd has said, is still out there. And I think everybody's starting to get into Christmas spirit, and we do appreciate everybody that comes here, and we do appreciate trying to share information with the public. Making sure they get the right information, I think, is always very important. And sometimes your comments allow us to then get the right information out to the public so that everybody is really informed the way they need to be. So I want to thank everybody very much for being here tonight and wish everybody a very Merry Christmas. Please be safe in your travels, and hope to see you at the open house.
All right, thank you. Councilmember Tressi.
Motion to adjourn.
Councilmember Phyllis.
I'll second.
I got a motion by Councilmember Tressi, a second by Councilmember Phyllis. All those in favor? Vote is unanimous. Meeting adjourned. Good job.